I mean, that's a pretty broad spectrum, too. So I'll just briefly describe two very different projects. One is a project that I'm working on right now called Milton with my company Pearl DeMoor. My name's Lisa DeMoor, and I'm a playwright, and my collaborator, Katie Pearl, is a director. And we've been making a lot of interdisciplinary site-specific work in big cities for many years. And we decided that we wanted to challenge ourselves to go outside our comfort zone, and we decided to start visiting five towns named Milton throughout the United States and interviewing people about their towns, their lives, and their worldviews. So we've been visiting Milton, North Carolina, Milton, Massachusetts, Milton, Wisconsin, Milton, Louisiana, and Milton, Freewater, Oregon for about a year and a half now. And we kind of think of them as five points in a constellation that stretches out across the United States. And so we've been having all sorts of experiences, as you can imagine, because many of these towns are quite small. And we're making a performance that's really a reflection of the complexity we found in these towns that pulls from both the interviews and our experiences, and also includes videos that we've been taking of the skies over each Milton. And we're pulling all of this together into this performance that we're going to bring back to each town. And we're premiering it in Milton, North Carolina, which has about 200 residents, in August in their women's club.
Perfect.
So that's one kind of vast. And then the other project that I'll say, which is just shorter and a little more idiosyncratic, is there's a mini musical that I've been working on with my husband, who's a composer, that's based on and pulls from the poetry of Du Fu, who was an 8th century Chinese poet. And I kind of fell in love with his writing, which was about natural disasters and writing and drinking and caring for your family. And I started just on a lark reading the poetry out loud in a southern accent. And it weirdly made the poetry very contemporary. And so we have this little musical called Du Fu, Mississippi, which is a bunch of people who live on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi talking and singing about floods, families, natural disasters, poetry, and drinking.
So, like you do.
Yes. So that's just like the opposite ends of the spectrum.
Okay. Great. Josh?
So two projects that I might briefly describe is one I made with a performance artist named Bradford Lorick about 7 or 8 years ago called Christine Jorgensen Reveals. And Bradford had discovered in a record store in Lower Manhattan that's now closed, like all the others, a record that said Christine Jorgensen Reveals and had this photo of Christine. And she was the first sort of famous transsexual who had her surgeries in 1952. And so he purchased the record, it was like $100, and thought it would be a great piece to do somehow. And we worked with a sound designer named Rob Kaplowitz and a dramaturg named Christy Evangelisto, and we basically presented that record as a live/non-live theater piece. And so Bradford, so we worked with Rob Kaplowitz to rearrange the questions into what felt like maybe a more satisfying arc as an audio piece. And then we filmed an actor named Rob Grace to lip-syncing to all of the interviewers' questions. And Bradford would lip-sync to all of Christine's answers. And we presented that as this sort of live theater piece. But it was live and yet not live, right? Because it was all lip-synced to this recording from 1958. And that piece sort of played in New York for about 6 months and then toured a bunch. And so that was one piece made out of source material. And then more recently, maybe 2 years ago or so, I was asked by this Spanish company called IENI to work with them devising a piece that was somehow based on Lorca's 1928 collection of poems, Poet in New York. And so we talked a bunch about what we wanted to do with that, and what we wound up doing was using that collection as a springboard to explore what it means to move to New York now as an artist and try and make work here. Because the entire company were Spanish nationals living in New York. And so we devised these pieces, much of which was textless, and also incorporated some of his poetry, a lot of his letters that he wrote back home, which were filled with lies, and then also some stuff that was sort of created about the experience of the individuals in the company, and made this sort of five-act piece that involved dance and live music and image and text, and presented it at the Duke on 42nd Street.
Great. Jody?
I had written about Ted Kaczynski some years ago in a book called Crimes of Art and Terror, and was very interested in the relationship between Kaczynski and Joseph Cornell. Had to do with the way that Kaczynski built his bombs and also what his cabin looked like. And so I was sort of, Kaczynski was some, I don't know if I should say this or not, was somewhere in my head. And then I almost was going to work with Neil Bell on an adaptation of Dreiser's The Financier, and this was right after the financial collapse in 08. But then some time passed, and Neil was unavailable, and then I was going to adapt it. And I read the novel, and I had read the novel, and then I went to read the novel again, and I thought, oh, the time for this is over. It's gone. And so I knew I needed another project, and I happened to meet at Duke a filmmaker named James Benning, who is a very interesting person who also shared a peculiar obsession with Mr. Kaczynski. And he had made a film called Two Cabins, and he had rebuilt Kaczynski's cabin and Thoreau's cabin, and he does sort of very stable camera long shots of the cabins in various weather situations for long periods of time. And in the cabin, he put, we now know what Kaczynski's favorite books were, and he put all of Kaczynski's books in the cabin, and he also put his own favorite books in the cabin that he rebuilt. And so I started thinking about Kaczynski again, and what did I want to do with him? And at first I was thinking I'm going to write a book about Kaczynski, and then I thought, well, I'm gonna read Kaczynski's favorite book, which was The Secret Agent, or is, he's not dead, The Secret Agent by Joseph Conrad. And I, Heart of Darkness is another book I've written about because of Apocalypse Now, and so I love Joseph Conrad, but I hadn't read this book, and I read it, and I loved it, and I thought, okay, this is gonna be, I'm gonna make a piece, and I have a script, and I'm gonna do it this fall. But I've adapted The Secret Agent, and it's really the idea is that Ted Kaczynski reads The Secret Agent. So Ted is, the whole play will probably come out of Ted's cabin, and Ted will play various roles, including, if for those of you who know the novel, the professor, who is in the novel and is a bomb expert and bears some chilling similarities to not only Kaczynski himself, but also to Mr. Kurtz, with his attitude toward humanity. And the book is I've spent some great time reading Conrad's letters about the book and what he was trying to do, and that was also very inspiring and challenging, because of course I faced the same challenges in trying to make a play out of it that he faced using an historical event, which was the Greenwich Observatory. Well, the observatory didn't get bombed, but they call it the Greenwich Observatory bombing, which happened in the late 19th century, and Conrad wrote the book in 05, and he invented a lot of the details. I mean, it's interesting, his own process about creating the novel, which involved a degree of invention and also a very concrete use of history in his adaptation, and I kind of faced the same thing. And with Kaczynski's materials, I now have access to the psychiatric report and a lot of materials, and probably this summer I'll go to University of Michigan to look at his papers, which are all in the Labadie collection there. And my husband said to me, well, you think you're really gonna see something that you don't already know? And I said, well, I was reminded of when I was a student and I went to look at O'Neill's papers in the Rare Book Library at Yale, and how deeply affecting it was to actually see the documents. You know, I have gotten really into documentary work lately, and I really appreciate seeing the object. And so I'm really looking forward to seeing the actual documents that Kaczynski handled. And so it's going to be, probably a disturbing and no doubt somewhat dangerous piece, I hope. And I'm really excited about it.
Great. Now, with each of you, and actually, Josh, you made reference to Lorca's Lies, so this kind of comes into that a little bit. Anytime you're working with material from another source, there's that whole question of, like, how much are you really going to utilize that? How much are you going to, you know, invent for yourself? So especially thinking, I think, Lisa, for you, thinking in terms of the Milton piece, since you're dealing with real people, real situations, I'd be really curious about that. And also, too, I'm wondering about, like, how you sort of approached these towns and sort of set yourself up. Like, how aware were they going into
of
the situation?
We
yes.
Yes. Let's see. Those are two really big questions, so I'll start with one
okay.
and see. We very much know that this piece is about seeing these towns through our eyes, me and Katie, who are artists in their early 40s, who are white women, who have spent most of their time in big cities. And that's actually acknowledged in the piece, that it's our point of view. We did many, many different kinds of interviews, and we really try, and I think we've done a pretty good job of getting a cross-section of ages and races in terms of the each town and genders. And and we kind of developed a format where we loosely would base these interviews and casual conversations around four questions. How did you get to Milton? If there was one thing you could change about the world, what would it be? What is your advice for future generations? And why do you think we are here on this earth? And so those were the kind of questions that framed these rambling conversations. And we actually, because we didn't want to, we actually didn't want to rely heavily, this isn't a piece like Anna Deavere Smith where we're portraying individuals from each town. And so, but what we wanted to convey was the complexity of opinions and diversity of experience in each town. So the piece actually feels like a performed list of everything from foods that we've eaten to objects that we witnessed to places that we've gone. And then there are moments when it's almost like within the complexity of this list, we focus in on one object or one person, and then you begin to hear that person's actual voice, a recording of their voice. And so for those people whose voices we're using, we're of course in conversation with them about getting permission to portray them in this way. But we've been, because there's so many, there's so much to try and convey about these towns, we've sort of steered clear around trying to make people in the town characters in the performance. So
sure.
There's also other ways within the performance to look through photos of the town and see objects and artifacts from the towns. So. I'll hold off right there so we have time for other
great.
People, and then we can...
That's great.
Yeah.
And Josh,
I'll come back. Yeah.
Okay. If you want to maybe... I know you talked a little bit about sort of this process of exploring, you know, Lorca's life and Lorca's work, and I think it's interesting, too, because especially for theater makers here, I'm thinking for most of us, we know Lorca's plays, but maybe not mm-hmm. much beyond that. Mm-hmm. So do you want to talk a little bit more about that and sort of how you approached it and how you all made decisions about what to include
sure.
and what not?
you know, I will be frank and say I find Lorca's poetry very opaque, and I really like and respond to several of his plays. But the poems are very abstract and very heightened, and for me were sort of difficult to access. That said, within the Spanish-speaking world, sort of across the globe, Lorca is like, you know, and the respect that that he holds is, you know, is like Shakespeare for us, right? But we sort of quickly felt that, like, some attempt to dramatize the poems or, you know, didn't feel satisfying to us. And instead, we did a lot of talking about our own relationship to Lorca as a figure, and did a lot of sort of devising around that. And what we came to was using Lorca as a cipher, really, for our own aspects of self that he seemed to hold. And so for me, I was very interested in lonesomeness and the sort of peculiar thing that I think exists in New York, which is that you're surrounded by, like, you know, 8 million people in this very dense, you know, small bit of geography, and yet it can feel incredibly lonesome. And he wrote in his diaries a lot about that feeling of alienation, and that seemed to strike a chord with a lot of the Spanish nationals in the company in terms of how they moved. So we started working with like images of Lorca as sort of images of ourselves. But we were very, we tried to be very frank that it was not about Lorca so much as it was about us via the lens of Lorca. With Christine Jorgensen, we had a very opposite experience, which is to say that we felt we didn't change anything from the recording, except we moved some of the questions around, but we didn't delete anything, we didn't move any of the answers from the questions, and we really wanted to respect and investigate that time capsule into and to try and explore what she, what sort of lives below the words in trying to inhabit this sort of very stilted recording. So we didn't change anything, and that was very much an historical artifact.
Okay. Jody, any are you feeling, as you're working on this project, are you feeling, this is going to sound odd, are you feeling a need to feel faithful to Kaczynski and his world, or do you feel free to sort of break free from it, I guess?
Well, it's really an invention, you know. When you adapt something, you have your own point of view, and I mean, I'm using actual text from the manifesto and finding ways to incorporate some of his writing. But the whole idea is, an invention. You know, the idea that Conrad, I mean, Kaczynski's going to be in his cabin and the secret agent is going to come alive and he's going to be part of it, you know. Mm. So I don't feel hampered, no. That's what you're asking, right? Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, constructed?
Things.
No. I don't think so.
And I guess kind of related to that too then is what about the secret agent itself? For those who, you know, who are special fans of that, are they going to be...
I'm one of those people that when I adapt something I translate too, and even I translated Gogol's Inspector General and made it the Special Prosecutor. So it was very contemporary. But I always try to hear the original work from my point of view, if that makes sense. That's mixing two senses, but maybe it makes sense.
No, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Can I add one other thing?
Absolutely.
There was a moment in the Lorca piece where we did do this sort of sleight of hand. And Lorca was in New York and witnessed the stock market crash in 1929. And when he returned to Madrid, he gave a speech about his experience witnessing that. And he says he would, went down to Wall Street and saw the people falling and all this stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, he spoke very movingly and impassionately about that experience. And while we were making the piece in 2011 or 2012, it was right at the height of the Occupy Wall Street sort of takeover of Zuccotti Park. And we worked with two playwrights in the group, a Spanish playwright named Mar Gomez-Glev and a Dutch playwright named Judith Gouchman. And Judith took Lorca's speech and combined it with a speech that Zizek gave down in Zuccotti Park. But we didn't acknowledge that shift at all. We just sort of let it merge together. And until the very end when the term Zuccotti Park was mentioned. And we felt that in sort of hiding the authorship of that, that we could make the point more strongly than we would if we simply sort of held the two pieces up next to each other or something. Because in fact, Lorca could have said all of the words that Zizek said, with the exception of the proper noun, right? So that was a place where deceit on our part felt important somehow.
It was like part of the perception shift of that moment.
Right. Yeah, right, yeah. Exactly.
That's great, yeah.
Well, and since you had already determined that he lied in his letters, you know, I think free reign. Lisa, do you want to address the question a little bit about approaching the towns and dealing with that, and then we'll kind of open it up to questions?
Sure. Yeah, I was thinking a little. One thing I want to make clear is that the performance is, Katie and I aren't performing it. We have performed in our work in the past, but it's being performed by three actors from who were casting out of New York, an older African-American woman, a middle-aged white man, and a young Hispanic woman, to try and start to reflect, the range of people. And, you know, this is a bit of an impossible project because there's no way that we can, you know, accurately reflect all of these people that we've talked to. And in some ways, the project is about what does it mean to live in America in your own town when you have all of these assumptions about who else is out there, which is kind of what drove us to create the piece. So we've learned a lot about how to interact with the towns, and in some ways our premiere in Milton, North Carolina is a real test case on the engagement, audience engagement, community engagement part of the project. Because what we realized once we started going like, oh, we'll visit these towns, we'll meet a few people, we'll make our piece and be done with it. And then as we started to get into these towns, many of whom are smaller towns that are trying to reinvent themselves, you know, suddenly we are artists who can be catalysts, potential catalysts for a lot of the things that these towns are already talking about. So in Milton, North Carolina, when we were discussing with a group of the community about how to prepare for our performance, the town decided they wanted to have a street fair, which is happening in about 2 weeks, which would allow local artists to give demonstrations and to kind of sell their wares, and there's going to be food, and Pearl DeMore is going to have our table out, and we're going to be teaching a cloud-making workshop, which is going to help make props for our performance later. And so it's this kind of collaboration with the town in that we're going to be creating some context for our show, meeting more people in the town, and also getting a little bit of the work done for our show when we go back in August. So it's been a real learning experience for me and Katie about what it means to fully engage with a new community. And a lot of our assumptions have been shattered about the people who live in these towns. And we're kind of hoping when we do have the chance to bring the piece back to like our home cities that we'll be able to shatter some city people's assumptions about who lives in these towns. So
great.
It's been great. Wild. It's been wild and awesome. So.
Cool. Well, let's open it up to the floor a little bit for questions, because I could just talk to these people for hours. But wait for the mic, Connie. Oh. The young lady in the back. Hang on 1 second. Scott is giving you a mic.
I think it died before.
Yeah. Everybody can hear me, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so these all sound absolutely wonderful. One of the things that occurs to me, particularly about the Lorca, is, and maybe Kaczynski, is getting the rights to use, in the case of Lorca, written works. I don't know how much time has passed. If there's a copyright issue.
Mm-hmm. We had to.
And then using Kaczynski's work, and then also Lisa, the translation
of the Dufu?
And just all everything that has to do with work that isn't completely original, that you do yourself, that isn't written by someone who's been dead for 400 years, mm-hmm. is there a rights issue? So I had that question, but more important to me is to say that this reminds me, particularly your work with Pearl DeMore, reminds me of what the Federal Theater wanted to do before it was shut down for being communist. Because, you know, it was such a pinko communist.
Right.
Yeah, they were doing Pinocchio. What a communistic evil. So I just think it's really exciting and really, really wonderful, all of these projects, contemporary
going right into things that are happening now, things that are being written about now, and responses that are very, very now. So that's a comment and the question.
You want me to answer?
Go for it.
The manifesto is not under copyright.
With Lorca, we did have to negotiate with the estate. There were only and with that negotiation, there was the the royalty depends on the actual amount of words that appear in the piece, and in fact, a very small amount of his actual words appeared in the piece, because we were really talking more about the figure of Lorca. With Christine Jorgensen, the pressing of that record was the rights were owned by the record company that produced it, which had gone out of business. So we took advantage of that and made a piece about it.
And with the Dufu piece, at this point we've only presented the piece once in the New Orleans Fringe Festival, and we actually know the two translators that we did use their actual translations mixed in with my words, and so we know that if we ever present it in a more formal context, we'll have to talk to the translators. But we kind of wanted to figure the piece out first, so we looked like we knew what we were doing.
Sure. Sure. Other questions?
Thanks. So this is a question for all of you, because you brought it up. I'm interested in the way that you talk about and would consider translating, if not an artist's work, three-dimensional physical object, and Jody mentioned the documents, obviously, the discal there. Josh, you can talk about the record. Lisa, I know your work has a lot of object inspiration. What's the weirdest thing that has inspired you or that you have adapted?
The weirdest object? I did a piece, I was approached about doing a piece about the gulag, which of course is something that everyone wants to do, right? I said, and sort of right on the spot, I said, it has to be Gulag Follies. Because for some reason, right into my brain came Titty Cut Follies, and Fred Wiseman's film about the Massachusetts prison for the criminally insane. This is, now you know how my mind works, okay. I had to look for, I needed some literature. I knew I was gonna have music and dance, but and I got some colleagues to work on that with me, but I found this writer, and the reason why I thought of this, because you said object, but Varlam Shalamov was actually in the Gulag, and he considered his work photographic. In nature, his writing he considered photographic, and he actually put it in the floor of the room where he had been interned, and so that actually became something that was in the play. They had to get it out of the floor, and also using documents. There was a marvelous. I had 10 young people, and there was a marvelous photo that I came across of a company that did living newspapers. And again, it was just sort of an object. It's a human being, but it's an object. And what there's nothing that makes a person more of an object than the gulag itself. And so these 10, I used a photograph as an image, both for costuming and even for an idea of how a company could approach this material and perform songs. The same way in Titty Cut Follies they do, the prisoners. The weirdest, when I hadn't seen the film in probably 20 years, and I went back and looked at it, and the opening scene is just ghastly. I mean, it's all the guards performing this insane thing with spinning, whatever you call those things, I can't remember the word. They like twirly objects, right, with hats on their heads and in this ghastly footlights. And I thought, oh, yeah, I'm in the right planet. I think of literature, like you say, it's my interest in the document of the printed word. Those are objects. Yeah, so, okay.
With With the Lorca piece, you know, we worked a lot with image and movement and textlessness, though there were also some sections of it that were very sort of densely texted. But you know, one of the things that I'm interested in is one of the things that I teach in the playwriting MFA program at Fordham, and one of the things that I teach there that I really enjoy is a course that's in part about trying to expand the notion of text for writers, right, and what text can be, because there's a way that I think image can communicate a certain density in an instant in a way that language is time-based, right? I mean, that great Gertrude Stein quote, sentences don't have meaning, paragraphs do. Right, that it takes time to accrue meaning with words. So we worked a lot with that in the Lorca piece, and because it was so live, we were really able to do that. With Christine Jorgensen, so we set the piece in a film studio, in a TV studio, because she had her surgeries in 1952 and the recording was pressed in 1958. And so it was at the dawn of this sort of technological revolution, cultural revolution, it sounds Maoist, but anyway, and that mirrors in some ways the technology of gender transformation, we've thought. And so, and it was our way of trying to acknowledge the recording itself, the actual LP. So the interviewer was videotaped lip syncing to the interviewer's recording questions, and that played through a sort of old 1950s looking television. And Christine and Bradford was the only sort of live actor who was on the stage lip syncing Christine's words. And the piece began before Christine enters the studio with the TV just turning on and some footage of the actual Christine and sort of what was happening with her. And it ends with, you know, at the very end of the interview, the lights faded on Bradford and the monitor, and the monitor sort of faded to black, and then it just clicked off. And I hoped that mirrored what I imagined to be Bradford's experience, putting the needle on the record and this voice sort of emanating out, right, and that ending when the needle came off. So we tried to put the artifact in some other way on the stage itself.
I thought of like three or four examples, so I'm going to give you one, but you can see me after. I was thinking about a piece which was eventually called Bird Eye Blueprint, where I was very obsessed with the mechanics of sight, how sight works. And I had seen this diagram of basically kind of explaining how like an image kind of comes in, I'm gonna get all the technical terms wrong, through the retina and gets turned upside down when it lands on the cornea and then pulled apart into many different sections that goes through these parts of the brain, and that there's this gap when scientists aren't quite sure how it all turns into a coherent whole that the brain can understand. And so Katie and I actually decided to structure the whole piece after this process and essentially this visual image. And so literally the performance was structured as a tour given by this kind of odd woman that you know as the blue dress lady, who was me. And she kind of leads you through her odd house, and this tour disintegrates and ends with her literally getting turned upside down against her will. And then the second part of the piece, the audience has to divide into groups, so they're pulled apart, and they kind of re-see a lot of the stops along the tour and interact with them, and then at a very quick pace, frantic pace, and then they're pulled together into a more traditional theater setting where they see a kind of quiet, almost dance performance version of her story at the end. So really, I just kind of used that picture and model as a structure for the whole show. So, there's video of it on the Pearl de Moor website that's pretty decent. So,
I have a question about the Milton interview questions.
Mm-hmm.
Since you were asking such potentially personal or charged questions.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get them to open up?
That's a really great question, because it took a lot of trial runs. And one thing that we, the structure that we realized is, like, the first interview we tried to do with a group of people at a Unitarian church, I think the first question we asked them is, do you think you can ever truly know another person? And they were like, they were completely shut down, because we didn't know that, you know. To us, that seemed like a pretty simple, interesting question, but it was just not yet. So it's part of why, and then actually in that interview, we said, okay, let's back up. How did you guys move here? And actually asking that simple question started them talking, and it almost started to get to some of these other questions that we wanted to ask. So we started to realize that the first thing is just to get people talking about what they really know. The other strategy we've been using is we meet the people, we have maybe an initial 5-minute chat telling them about who we are and the kind of work we do. And then we say out front, we usually structure these interviews with 4 questions. Do you want to hear them? We say they range from the practical to the esoteric. Would you like to hear them? And they've all said yes. And then we lay out the 4 questions. And there's always this moment where they go, whoa, or they kind of laugh, or they're like, I don't know about that. And inevitably, within 5 or 10 minutes, they're like, can we go back to that question about the one thing I would change? And then they start to talk about that. So we often don't get to all the questions, but we kind of leave it open as an invitation for them to answer whichever one they would like. So.
Other questions?
I just wanted to know, what are the 4 questions?
Oh, so the 4 questions are, how did you get to Milton? If there was one thing you could change about the world, what would it be? What is your advice for future generations? And why do you think we are here on this earth? Are the 4 questions. And they kind of, sometimes the answer to one is related to the answer to another. So.
I did some simpler work to this on South Dakota about 3 or 4 years ago. And one of the things you said, you might have already answered this, I'm sorry if I repeat.
That's okay.
Yeah,
we tell them that none of their words will be used unless we ask them.
But they knew it was a play.
Well, interestingly enough, yes, they knew it was a play, but then inevitably, no matter how carefully we would describe it, when they would introduce us to someone else, they would tell them that we're making a documentary, even though we don't film or anything. It's very, we've actually found in a lot of places that it's just hard to kind of get across that we're actually bringing a live performance to them. It's just not, you know, usually people are doing a book or an article or a documentary. So I still am curious in fact, when I called the woman who runs the women's club last week, I said, so can we, you know, we're gonna use the club for this week. And she was like, oh good, and then you're gonna show the film? And I said, no, it's not, it's actually not. It's all gonna be fine, because I think they're gonna be really interested in what we have, but yeah. So.
I've got a quick one. I'm just curious, because I've done works from other material and adaptations and that type of thing. Is there anything where you've considered creating a piece and then found out somebody else got there first, or was working on something at the same time? Because that's always a concern. Because there are things that do come up for us, especially along themes.
My ideas are always way too obscure. It's never really that much of an issue.
What, everybody's not doing boohoo? I don't
understand. No, the closest thing would be that I discarded the financier because I felt that it had lost its friction for me. Mm-hmm. You know.
I mean, certainly Lorca is someone that is done in many different ways and sort of all over the place, and has inspired many other works. But I don't know, in a way that was sort of freeing, because we felt like, well, we're not, you know, it's not about Lorca, it's about us, and the only us's are us, so. Yeah.
Okay. 30 seconds, everybody sing. I think we'll call it good there. Thank you to all the panelists.
Thank you.